to is this practice test. Now, this practice test is just multiple choice, and it's from a commercially made book. I don't remember what book I got it from, but it's not actual. These questions aren't generated by the College Board itself, but they are similar to the kind of College Board questions. And so you have 55 questions in 55 minutes. You have for each of the questions some kind of text or illustration, you know, and then you have questions about the text or illustration. You have the topics of the text and pictures and cartoons. And so these are good, you know, these are good to practice from, you know, just doing these questions and answering them and, you know, looking up the answers if you don't know it, if you're not familiar with the topic. These kinds of practice tests are good, you know, to take a look at. Now, take a look at the one that I just gave you. And that is, okay, so that is the document-based question, section three, the document-based question. So if you look down there where it says question one down at the bottom of this page on this handout right here, this is a question that was given as an example by the College Board of a type of question you might expect to see as a document-based question. Now, if you look at the question, it says evaluate the extent of change in continuity in the lives of African Americans in the South during the period 1865 to 1905, right? So the prompt itself isn't remarkable. I mean, you know, the document-based prompts and the long essay prompts aren't going to be remarkably different. The difference is with this prompt, there are seven documents that accompany this prompt. So the first thing that you would want to do if you were addressing this question, I think you have 55 minutes to do this as well. But the first thing that you'd want to do is the typical first thing that you do anytime you write an essay, and that's try to figure out exactly what the question is asking you to do. Now the verb in the question is a verb that we've had multiple times in class, evaluate. What word is synonymous with evaluate? So we say you are to evaluate.
Judge,
right? Judge the extent, right? The extent, the level of change in continuity in the lives of African Americans in the South during the period 1865 to 1905. Now, circle the word lives, right? So we're going to evaluate, right, the extent of change, how much change. So that ultimately what this question is asking us to do is we're going to evaluate the extent of change in the lives of African Americans in the South at that time period, and the extent of continuity. And so the question ultimately is, how much did things change for black people in the South, and how much did things stay the same, right, in their lives? But let's circle the word lives, and then underneath where you circled, write the following things. Right, so how would we define their lives? If we were gonna look at, you know, assessing this, right, evaluating how much the lives of African Americans changed, or how much they stayed the same in this time period, right? We have to have an idea of what we mean by lives, right? What about their lives? So write the following: economic opportunity. So then we would say, how much did things change in terms of economic opportunity? Social mobility. How much did it change in terms of African Americans being able to move socially up in terms of class, you know, along the social sort of ladder? Political influence and civil rights. Now, when I think of lives, and if I was scrutinizing this question, I would say, okay, how much were things the same for African Americans in terms of economic opportunity? How much were the same or change in terms of social mobility, political influence, and civil rights? Now I want you to look at that, and I want you to like realistically think. Can you think of anything else that would be something that would be an area that you would look at under the word lives, right, in terms of change and continuity? So we're talking about black people in the South. We're talking about the period 1865 to 1905. We are assessing and evaluating and judging the extent to which there was change in the extent to which things stay the same in their lives. So I kind of said lives to me means economic opportunity, social mobility, civil rights, and political influence. Is there anything else that you would include in that? I'm not saying, that's just a quick kind of thinking in my part. Yes, go ahead.
Like family lives, like being able to marry.
Okay, yeah, what would you call that? You would call family life? Okay, we'll call it family life. We'll write that down. I think that's good, family life, right? What else? Is there anything else? I was trying to think of like culture. Yes.
Oh, I was going to say like conditions. Like
living conditions. Like, family life. We'll put it on the same thing. Family life and living conditions. Right? Okay. Okay. I'm trying to think of like culture. You know, like we're talking about the culture of the 20s. You know, I don't know how I would describe it. Isn't that a part of life? You know, your you know, embrace of culture and, you know, I don't know. Yeah, go ahead.
Religion?
Yeah, maybe. Religion, that's good. No, always, always. No, I don't think that, yeah, go ahead.
Can you say health?
Yeah, okay, let's say health, you know, in terms of, you know, their overall well-being. Let's say well-being, you know, their overall well-being. And so we wouldn't have to look at all of those things, but I think those things would be the things we've been thinking about, right? Now, what's the significance of 1865 in the question? Why did they choose that number in looking at African Americans in the South? What's the significance? Yes.
The end of the Civil War.
Yes, that's the end of the Civil War. And not only is it the end of the Civil War, more significantly for African Americans, it represents the passage of the 13th Amendment. Right? So in terms of ending slavery, certainly the Civil War itself, right? The Civil War itself was not at least originally intended to end slavery. Remember, Lincoln very, very, you know, consciously pointed out in his inaugural address that he never ever said that he would end slavery where it already existed. That what Lincoln had said from the very beginning is that he wanted to stop the spread of slavery and put it on the course of ultimate extinction. Now, what that meant to white Southerners, you know, they were unsure of. And I mean, they mentioned that a lot as justifying, you know, their secession, because Lincoln had clearly stated that he wanted to stop the spread of slavery and put it on the course of ultimate extinction. That's why they seceded from the Union when he was elected to the presidency with no Southern support at all, along with a Republican House and a Republican Senate and potentially a Republican Supreme Court, right? So that's why they seceded from the Union. But Lincoln clearly stated that you know, his intention was not to touch slavery where it existed, and he was careful not to do so through the first year or two of the war. But in September of 62, in the aftermath of the Battle of Antietam, Lincoln is going to announce that as of January 1st, 1863, all slaves that were in rebellious territory would be henceforth and forever free. Right, that was the Emancipation Proclamation. Now, the Emancipation Proclamation, as we know, didn't free all the slaves. It only freed slaves that were in rebellious territory, in which really Lincoln didn't have any control over anyways. However, wherever the Union Army went and liberated those areas from Southern control, the slaves in those territories would be henceforth and forever free. Now, in order to finally end slavery, however, a constitutional amendment had to be passed, right? So the 13th Amendment to the Constitution passed the House of Representatives and the Senate in January of 65 and was subsequently ratified by three-fourths of the states, and that's what ends slavery, right? Now, once slavery is ended, the question is, what will be the status and condition of the 4 million freed slaves, right? So when we look at, you know, the end of the Civil War and the beginning of the Reconstruction of the country, we said that the big challenge, I mean, we listed in class, I don't know if you remember, we kept saying there are these five challenges, you know, and one of them was what would happen to these 4 million slaves. So ex-slaves now, ex-slaves as a result of the 13th Amendment. So now this question is saying, okay, what happened to their status from immediate emancipation through this time period, right, through this time period. So let's go, and we could brainstorm about that now and say, let's think about that a little bit. Based on that, is there anything that comes to mind that you recall from our conversation of that period that you would think you could incorporate into a response? Is there anything that comes to mind? Go ahead.
Black codes.
Yeah, the black codes, and we'll get to that in a second. I'll put that in the context. But the black codes, yes. Anything else you could think of that happened, a specific event, a person, you know, a piece of legislation, you know, anything that happened in that? Go ahead, Tom.
The amendment of the 14th Amendment.
Yes, we have the subsequent 14th and 15th Amendment. Now, the 14th Amendment, you know, made the slaves citizens and provided for those slaves equal protection under the law. And what did the 15th Amendment do, Savannah? Yes, African American males the right to vote. So, okay, we're thinking about it. Thinking about that, we say, well, you know, look, I mean, the status of slaves clearly, you know, may have changed in some ways, politically at least, you know, for a period of time. But after we kind of think about what we know when we do a document-based question, then we quickly want to get in to the documents, right? And so the question is, you know, how did things change and how did things stay the same? And let's look at document one. Right, document one, the source is Thaddeus D. Oh, before we do that, before we look at document one, and I should have probably done this before, let's go back for a second. You know, we jumped right into this question. But look above the question there just quickly. And in your response to this question, what the AP is saying to you is they are going to grade you on a 7-point scale. Right? Zero to seven. It's conceivable to get zero. Right? It's conceivable to get zero. You can get nothing from your response, right? Nothing. And it's the most you can get is seven. Right? So if you look at those things before we continue, if you have a thesis, present a thesis that makes a historically defensible claim in response to all parts of the question, then you would get 1 point. And so to respond to all parts of the question, you would have to address in your thesis your viewpoint about how much things changed for African Americans and how much things changed and stayed the same. I don't know how exactly I want to do that, but let's go back to the documents. And then after we go through all those documents, then we'll come back and talk about what we have to do, right? And then we'll review it. So let's go back to the documents. I just want to think about how it might make sense, right? And I'm looking at these documents, and I should tell you that when you write the document-based question for the AP, there's going to be 7 documents. They want you to incorporate in some manner or another 6 of them, right? So you cannot get the point without incorporating 6 of the 7. So you have to incorporate 6 of the 7. So the first one is by Thaddeus Stevens, and look at the date, right? Look at the date. It's Thaddeus Stevens, the date is October 18th, 1865. Who was Thaddeus Stevens? Does anybody remember besides the instructor who Thaddeus Stevens was with? And the best thing that I can hope for you to remember in terms of Thaddeus Stevens is what group he was associated with, right? Thaddeus Stevens was a Pennsylvania congressman, member of the House of Representatives, chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, who was?
Was he a radical?
He was a radical Republican, right? He was somebody, and remember, the radical Republicans were that faction of Republicans after the war who want to punish the South. They want justice. Remember we said the big kind of debate, you know, after the Civil War was healing versus justice. What do we want Reconstruction to look like? Do we want Reconstruction to focus more on justice, or do we want Reconstruction to focus more on healing? Now, you know, the African-American, former African-American slaves are central to that. If you focus on justice, you try to make up for what was taken from those people by slavery all those generations. You know, and if you focus on justice, you punish the people that enslaved them and started the war in the first place, which was the Confederacy. If you focus on healing, then you say, hey, how can we make nice quickly, and everybody could go back to kind of, you know, being part of the United States. Stevens was a radical Republican, an adamant radical Republican, that wanted justice. He wanted the South to be punished and the slaves to kind of be, I don't want to say rewarded, but I think he wanted the slaves to be treated with fairness beyond, just freedom. That there had to be some kind of recognition of what they lost. And let's just briefly look at the document, and you can see that in this document. And this is December of 65, right? So this is just in the kind of immediate wake of the war ending here. We have turned, or about to turn, loose 4 million slaves without a hut to shelter them, or a cent in their pockets. The infernal laws of slavery have prevented them from acquiring an education, understanding the commonest laws of contract, or of managing the ordinary business of life. This Congress is bound to provide for them until they can take care of themselves. If we do not furnish them with households and hedge them around with protective laws, if we leave them to the legislation of their late masters, we had better off left them in bondage. Their condition would be no worse than that of our prisoners at Andersonville. If we fail in this great duty now, then we have the power, when we have the power, we shall deserve and receive the denunciation of history and of all future ages. You know, that's a really good document for this question, don't you think? And here's why. What's he saying? If we don't do these things, then things are in essence going to stay the way they were. Right? I mean, isn't that a good document for this idea of continuity? Right? I mean, what he is saying is, look, if we don't do these things for these people, then they'll basically, we might as well have left them in slavery. That things will stay the way they were. Right? You know. So now the question is that true? Now let's talk a little bit about what happened. You know, to set the context of Thaddeus Stevens' thing. So remember what happened. The 13th Amendment is proposed in Congress and passes both houses, is on the road to being ratified. The war ends in April, right? You know, before the war, you know, ended, Lincoln had developed the 10% plan, right? Now, you remember that? The questions, you know, okay, how about reincorporating the ex-Confederate states? You know, how about, you know, creating new governments? Lincoln had proposed the 10% plan, which was considered a very lenient plan. That allowed for the ex-Confederate states to after 10% of the people that voted in the 1860 election took an oath of allegiance, they could call for a special convention, or they could call for a convention, write a new state constitution. The 10% plan did not mandate that African Americans, former slaves, be given the right to vote. It left the status and condition of those former slaves up to those new state legislatures. Right, that would be made up generally of white people that pledged loyalty to the United States. Right, and remember, Lincoln pardoned all kinds of people, and so this was really, really a very lenient plan that leaned heavily towards healing. Right, remember we said that the 10% plan was rejected by radicals, and they proposed the Wade-Davis bill in the summer of 64. Lincoln's 10% plan was in December of 63. The summer of 64, the Wade-Davis bill was a plan that leaned more towards justice, right, than healing, right? But the war was still going on at this time. In January of 65, the 13th Amendment passes, but Congress also rejects, in February, Congress rejects Louisiana, who had reorganized themselves under the 10% plan. So the battle between Lincoln and the radicals, and the battle between justice and healing over Reconstruction, is sort of raging, right? Now, it's unsettled, right? You know, Congress passes the Freedmen's Bureau. Oh, incidentally, what was the Freedmen's Bureau? Does anybody remember? The Freedmen's Bureau is passed in February of 65. Does anyone besides the instructor and Kronka remember what the Freedmen's Bureau? You do not. You do.
It was to help the African Americans. Like,
it was this kind of relief agency, almost like, you know, it was a combination of like FEMA, you know, emergency relief. Yes.
Like,
yeah, I mean, they didn't like it. White Southerners did not like the Freedmen's Bureau because it was intended to help African-American former slaves incorporate into the larger society, to address those things that Thaddeus Stevens was saying that slaves lacked: money, understanding of contracts, you know, a house, a shelter, education, all of these things. The Freedmen's Bureau was to facilitate that between the White South and the former slaves, right? You know, it was passed, and the White South hated the Freedmen's Bureau, right? Now, Lincoln dies and Johnson takes over, and Johnson continues, you know, basically Lincoln's lenient approach to reincorporating the southern states, which ends up really putting the, you know, African Americans in those states in kind of a difficult situation. Now, we said this, that we said by December, by the time Stevens is writing this, by December of 65, all of the ex-Confederate states had reconstructed themselves under the Lincoln / Johnson policies. Okay? Now, the last thing that had to happen, remember we talked about this? We said that, you know, here's this dispute between Lincoln and the radicals. Lincoln dies, and Johnson takes over, and Johnson, with some slight modification, continues Lincoln's plans. You know, and by December of 65, the war ends in April. This is December. Thaddeus Stevens is writing this in December, right? The war ends in April. By December, all those states have done did what Lincoln or Johnson had told them to do. They were all ready to take their to be readmitted to the Union. The only thing they had written new constitutions. They had elected new state officers. The only thing that had to happen was that the representatives that had been elected in those states to be members of the Senate and the House of Representatives in Washington had to come to those chambers and take their seats. And they were ready to do so. They were ready to take their seats, and Northern representatives and Congress said, no way. They rejected them. They said, we will not allow you, right? We will not allow you to take your seats. We reject Reconstruction under the presidential plan. Why? What were the two things that they objected to? Northerners objected to two things that emerged during presidential Reconstruction, causing them to say, this is unacceptable. And remember, this is the context that Stevens is talking about, right? He's in that context, in that time, when Northerners are saying, unacceptable. These Reconstruction plans under Lincoln, now dead, but beloved, but dead, and Johnson alive and hated, right, are no good. Two things. Anybody remember? Liz, do you remember? You do not. Yes, Micah, do you remember?
Only 10% of former voters shall take the vote.
Yeah, that's true, and they rejected that, but there were two things. One of them was already mentioned. One of them was already mentioned in our brief brainstorming thing, when we said, what do we remember?
The 14th Amendment.
No. The two things, maybe I'm asking this question incorrectly. The two things that bothered Northerners about Reconstruction under Lincoln and Johnson's plans were the black codes, right? And who was elected, who the Southerners chose to represent them in Congress, right? So remember, they chose ex-Confederate generals. Alexander Stevens, the vice president of the Confederacy, was selected by the state of Georgia to represent. They didn't like the people that these new southern states chose to represent them in Congress. Several of them were Confederate generals. Stevens was under indictment for treason. Some of them were officers and, you know, not officers, but they were elected representatives in the Confederacy. They chose these people, and those ex-Confederates were going to come and take their seats. And the other thing they resented were the black codes. Now, what were the black codes? What were the black codes? Each one of those states, all of those ex-Confederate states, passed state laws that were collectively known as the black codes. What were they?
Yes. Like separate but equal?
Not yet. Yeah, go ahead, Savannah. Go ahead, Courtney, the black codes. Now, funny you would not know that, because let's look at document two. Document two here is an example of a black code, right? So the source there is the laws of St. Landry Parish, Louisiana, 1865. Now let's read this. I mean, this is a pretty disturbing document. This is an example. So now when I say an example of the black codes were different in every single state, right? So, but they all did the things that were similar to this, right? So let's think about this. Does this represent continuity or change for the status of African Americans in terms of the things that we listed under lives, right? So go back and look at what we listed under life: economic opportunity, right? Social mobility, right? Well-being, family life. These are all the things that we're interested in looking at, right? And now here's what happens when the ex-Confederate states are left to create, you know, to deal with African Americans themselves. And remember what Thaddeus Stephen warned. He said, if we let them, this is what they'll do, right? So let's just read this quickly. No Negro shall be allowed to pass within the limits of said parish without a special permit in writing from his employer. Whoever shall violate this provision shall pay a fine, or in default thereof shall be forced to work 4 days on the public road, or suffer corporal punishment as provided herein after. No Negro shall be permitted to rent or to keep a house within said parish. Any Negro violating the provision shall be immediately ejected and compelled to find an employer. Every Negro is required to be in regular service of some white person or a former owner who shall be held responsible for the conduct of said Negro. Any Negro violating the provisions of this section shall be fined, or in default of payment thereof, shall be forced to work 5 days on the public road, or suffer corporal punishment hereinafter provided. No Negro shall be permitted to preach, exhort, or otherwise declaim to congregations of colored people without special permission in writing from the president of the police jury. Any Negro violating the provisions of this section shall pay a fine, or in default thereof, shall be compelled to work 10 days on the public road, or suffer corporal punishment as hereinafter provided. No Negro who is not in military service shall be allowed to carry firearms of any kind of weapons within the parish without special written permission of his employers, approved and endorsed by the nearest and most convenient chief of patrol. It shall be the duty of every citizen to act as a police officer for the detection of offenses and the apprehension of offenders, who shall be immediately handed over to the proper captain or chief of patrol. So that's an example of a black code, right? Now, how would you use that? Continuity or change? Yes. You're saying they're still virtually enslaved, correct? Dear Savannah? Still virtually enslaved. Go ahead.
I'm saying this is continuity.
Also, Northerners, yeah, I mean, so this is continuity, and Northerners reject. Why do Northerners reject this? They don't like this. Is it because they're compassionate to African Americans? Why did we say they rejected things like the black codes? Go ahead.
They wanted the South to pay for what they did. They didn't want them to have to
fight. Yes, and remember, they had fought to free the slaves. And Savannah is making the case here that this is just de facto slavery, right? I mean, this is just slavery. This is continuity of the way things were. So you could make an argument of continuity. Is there anything to make an argument of change in that? For the status, I mean, we could pick economic opportunity. You could pick, yeah. Go ahead. Go ahead. No. Okay. Let's go to the next document.
Document 3. Right.
Now, I would say that document 1 and 2 put you in presidential reconstruction. Okay. So here's what happens next. Presidential reconstruction is rejected by the North. Correct? The Northerners say, hey, this is no good. We want, you know, these things revised. And then starting in 66, Johnson and the Northerners are going to battle over Reconstruction. You know, the Northerners are going to reject Reconstruction with the black codes and with, you know, the people that are elected. They are going to want, you know, a Reconstruction program that leans more towards justice. But Johnson is unwilling to compromise at all. He basically says to the to the ex-Confederate states, we're not changing anything. You are reconstructed. That's it. The culmination of the battle between Johnson and Congress, I mean, remember, Congress passed a Civil Rights Act that would protect, that would negate the black codes, right? Congress renewed the Freedmen's Bureau, which would help African Americans. Johnson vetoed both of these things. And eventually, Congress, in order to ensure African Americans had equal rights and, you know, the ex-Southerners were disenfranchised from voting and participating in government in the South, passed the 14th Amendment. The 14th Amendment was passed through Congress in the summer of 66, right? In the summer of 66. And then the battle for the ratification of the 14th Amendment was important. Now, the 14th Amendment is not mentioned anywhere in here. So it would be considered outside information. And one of the things that you are judged on is, do you incorporate into your response outside information? So nowhere in here is there a reference to the 14th Amendment. Nowhere is there a reference to the 13th Amendment or the 15th Amendment. Right? All of that would be considered to be outside information. Now, remember we talked about Johnson telling them to do this in the congressional elections of 66? Were going to be the referendum by the nation, whether the country, the North in particular, supported Johnson's vision of healing, or whether they supported the radical Republicans or the congressional vision of justice that surrounded the 14th Amendment. The 14th Amendment, incidentally, you know, proclaimed everyone born on U.S. soil citizens and demanded that U.S. citizens be assured equal protection under the law, right? Which basically made the black codes unconstitutional. So when the Republicans won huge majorities in the 66 election, right? When they took office in 67, they threw out all of the presidential Reconstruction and launched what became known as Congressional Reconstruction or Radical Reconstruction. Now, you can see in document 3, Radical Reconstruction is going to be just that. I mean, it's called radical because it involved the radical Republicans, but it is radical in some ways. Now remember, in the radical regimes, these new state governments in the South under congressional Reconstruction, African American males were entitled to vote in those states, to participate in government, right, in those states. They were offered equal rights under the 14th Amendment in those states. Now we see that in document 3 with the number of African Americans that were in the House of Representatives and Senate. And you can see that prior to the congressional election of 69, there were none. Then it went from 3 to 5 to 8 and then down to 4, 1, 2, 2. Right? So what do you make of this? How might you use this in terms of, go ahead, Samantha.
I would say that as the member increases, that's when the Reconstruction began.
So what do you call that, continuity or change?
Well, it's changing the number of articles, continuity comes down, people don't have four,
So how do you think you would handle that in your essay? This idea that for this time period, African Americans had kind of political opportunities. I mean, how would you handle that? Go ahead, Micah.
There was a period of intense change until the Democrats took back over, and then it resumed to continuity.
So you think you could hedge that in your introductory paragraph to say, in terms of political rights, there was both continuity and change, right? You know, there was a period of change, and then it was back to continuity of being. You know, so originally African Americans had no political voice, no political say, and then there was a period of change where they had some political say, but it went back to them not having political say. Right? Yes?
I would say it's changed because before they had like no political say because there were actually zero African Americans represented, but then at least by the end there were at least a few, so it was evolved.
Okay, go ahead, Emma.
I think that both comes from change, but I think it's also see that it's continuity because it keeps on going back up and back down. They're not actually an African American before
So you could probably make that case though, Emily, and say, you know, in reality there was no change. Black people just didn't have rights. Right? Even though there were blips, and you could make that argument. You know, you could focus your argument on political rights. You could focus it on economic opportunity, on both. You know, go ahead.
I was going to say that kind of said basically, once the number got back to zero, that's when they were like almost completely disenfranchised, and that like shows no change whatsoever.
Yes. So then ultimately, you're kind of dismissing any blip as being change.
Right.
The change by its very nature has to be continual, not an aberration, which is an interesting point. Now let's go to document four quickly. We go to document four, you know, radical reconstruction. What's the response of Southerners to radical reconstruction? And document four sets you in 1871. So 1871 is in radical reconstruction because radical reconstruction starts in 67, ends in 77, a 10-year period, right? And here is Lucy McMillan, an African-American woman, testimony before the United States Congress Joint Select Committee and to inquire into the condition and affairs in the late insurrectionary states, Spartanburg, South Carolina, 1871. Question, did the Ku Klux Klan come where you live at any time? Answer, Monday night they came and burned my house down. I dodged out alongside the road not far off and saw them. I was sitting right not far off, and as they came along the river, I knew some of them. I knew John McMillan and Kennedy McMillan and Billy Bush and John Hunter. They were all together. I was not far off, and I saw them. They went right to my house. Then they passed, and I ran further up the hill to get out of the way of them. They went there and knocked down and beat my house right smart while. And then they got all still, and directly I saw the fire rise. Question, what was the reason given for burning your house? Answer, there was speaking down there last year and I came to it. Question, where was the speaking? Here in this town. I went on and told them, and then they all said I was making laws and going to have the land, and the Ku Klux Klan were going to beat me for bragging that I would have land. Question, was this the only reason you know for your house being burned? Answer, it's all the reason. All the Ku Klux Klan said, all that they had against me was I was bragging and boasting that I wanted land. Right? So we know that the response let me ask you this though before we answer the question. Continuity or change, this document? How could you use it? Go ahead, Sam. Good. Go ahead, Emily. Not yet. Well, she had a house. Yeah.
She had a house. Yeah. And she could actually hope to earn more and to create laws and to participate in the
community. Yeah. Okay. Anybody else? Continuity or change? Right? Okay. So we know that the Klan was the response to radical reconstruction. And we also know that they were successful, that the Ku Klux Klan was successful, that by 1877, the Klan, let's see what the next slide is. The next document is Klan related also. So 5 and 6 are related to Klan. And look at 5 though really quickly. The interview with Henry Blake, an African American farmer in Little Rock, Arkansas. part of the Federal Writers Project, a government program during the Great Depression. That's the WPA. Remember I talked about the WPA, the Federal Writers Project? That's Federal Writers Project. That's the WPA. But back, that was also, you know, that was also during Radical Reconstruction. So let's say this. Radical Reconstruction ends because of the Ku Klux Klan and their resistance and their violence, and Northerners become weary of using money and troops to provide stability. The notion that African Americans were virtually incapable of, you know, serving in government, corruption, all of the kind of misinformation about the radical regimes, wartime weariness, the generations, people like Stevens dying off, you know, and kind of giving up on hopes of creating a pluralistic society in the South, all leads to the end of Reconstruction. And remember, the end of Reconstruction is the election of 76. Does anyone besides the instructor know who the candidates were in the election of 76 and why we said it ended Reconstruction? Yes. Yes, great. Yeah, Hayes and Tilden. And who ended up winning, and why was that significant for Reconstruction?
Hayes won because a whole bunch of Africans voted was about to win, but Tilden said like Hayes even went like that.
Yeah, so Hayes wins the actual election, but Tilden should have won. And the, you know, there was all kinds of machinations that surrounded that. But at the end of the story, basically the Republicans agreed that they would withdraw troops from the South if the Democrats agreed to accept Hayes's election, right? And the final withdrawal of troops of the South was the end of Reconstruction, because the only way these Republican regimes could exist is if there were Northern bayonets in the South. So Reconstruction ends in 77, technically. You know, remember we listened to David Blight, and David Blight said, when did Reconstruction really end? You know, did it end before that? Did it end after that? That's a question of periodization. You know, when did the spirit of Reconstruction really end? But we usually end it in 77. And then we say, what's true of African Americans in the aftermath of the end of Reconstruction? Political disenfranchisement, right? You know, social segregation. And what are the laws that socially segregate black people after Reconstruction ends? Black codes are gone. What are the laws? Jim Crow laws. Are not the black codes, but they are similar. They are not going to re-enslave African Americans. The Jim Crow laws are going to segregate African Americans, not fully re-enslave them, right? I mean, I don't know. That's an interesting question in itself. Does the Jim Crow, do Jim Crow laws represent continuity and change? You had, I mean, think about this. You could do this. You could go slavery, black code, Jim Crow. Continuity or change? I think you could make an argument for either, right? You could make an argument, depending upon what you look at, you could make an argument for continuity. And you could make an argument for change, right? Albeit modest change, but you could, depending upon what you pick there, you could make an argument for continuity and change, right? And continuity or change with slavery, black codes, Jim Crow. Oh, what was the Supreme Court? Oh boy, could you imagine if you would incorporate this into your paper, Savannah? Go ahead. Plessy versus Ferguson. What does Plessy versus Ferguson do? Yes, go ahead. You do. I'm gonna go with Cho. Cho, you've been a sleeping lion most of the class. You know what it is, don't you? Go ahead.
Is it legalized segregation?
Yes, it constitutionalized the Jim Crow laws, right? It said that separate but equal was constitutional. So you have political disenfranchisement, social segregation, and economic dependency with sharecropping. Right? Now, let's go to documents 6 and 7. The AP loves Ida B. Wells. Ida B. Wells is, and here, Ida B. Wells is talking about, she's kind of reflecting on the whole question. Let's just read the first part. We were liberated, not only empty-handed, but left in the power of people who resented our emancipation as an act of unjust punishment on them. They were therefore armed with a motive for doing everything in their power to render our freedom a curse rather than a blessing. So that's an interesting two sentences right there. You could say that, look, Ida B. Wells is kind of saying we never really achieved freedom, right? The continuity is where we're never free. Whether we might not have been a slave, but we were never free. This is an interesting approach to it as well, right? Now, let's just quickly, just another few minutes. You know, then you have document 7, all right? William Sinclair, and that's 1905. And so that's going to be the aftermath. Now let's quickly go to the front page again. And what do you got to do here to get all 7 points, right? So we've got a lot of ideas about this, and we've kind of taken African Americans from slavery, you know, through presidential reconstruction, radical reconstruction, and then that period after 1877 up to the turn of the century. And in our class, that's when we brought in Booker T. Washington and W.E.B. Du Bois, the progressive era not being good for black people. World War II is really going to be what shakes this whole thing up, incidentally, right? What shakes the entire kind of, you know, calculus with African Americans, you know, in terms of segregation in the South is going to be World War II. One, because the war is such a you know, monumental national effort that, you know, the America is going to have to, you know, incorporate African Americans into the war. Now, all through the war, everything in World War II is segregated. You know, units are segregated, pilots are segregated. Roosevelt refuses to desegregate the military, you know, during World War II. It is Truman in 1948 that desegregates the military. But that notwithstanding, the big kind of thing that brings the conditions of African Americans to the forefront that has to do with World War II is that we are fighting oppression. You know, we are fighting Nazi oppression, we are fighting Japanese oppression, and then after the war, we are fighting communist oppression. Well, I mean, the communists and everybody point to America and say, wait a minute, you guys are oppressing your own people here, and you argue you are fighting for global freedom, you know, in this sort of noble cause. And it brings to the forefront the you know, the kind of irony of the way that African Americans in the South are treated. And that's going to really set the stage for, you know, change, meaningful change. But okay, so we know what a thesis is, we can do that. Argument development is really going to be, the thesis is 1 point. Argument development includes making an argument, using documents, sourcing those documents. It's basically, is that 3 points? 4 points. Those 4 points out of those three areas. You have to put 6 of the 7 documents somehow or another in the paper, right? Mentioning them to get one of those points. You've got to source them to get the other point. Now look at what sourcing says here. Sourcing said, explain the significance of author's point of view, author's purpose, historical context, audience for at least 4 of the documents. Right? Now, would saying that Thaddeus Stevens was a radical Republican and committed to justice over healing, would that be, you know, in incorporating that into the source there, would that be kind of establishing the author's point of view? Probably. Right, probably, where you have to comment some way, some level on the source. You know, Stevens, a radical Republican, intent on demanding justice, even argue and make reference to the source, you know, and try to, you know, his point of view or his purpose. The Black Codes, purpose of the Black Codes, for example, Landry Parrish in 65, was, you know, to oppress African Americans. Purpose, point of view, for 4 of the 6 documents. 2 of them you can just merely mention. 4 of the 6 you have to source, right? And then outside evidence would also be part of the argument, you know, part of your argument, in where you would incorporate into your argument things that aren't in the document. Contextualization is you put your whole argument into a larger historical context. And synthesis, we've talked about numerous times, that's when you connect it to something before or something after. Now, if you do all of those things, you get 7 points. But remember, I told you that the national average was less than two, right, last year. Less than two was the national average. So if you could get four, you're killing it, right? You're doubling the national average if you can get four. And I'm pretty confident that all of you can do an introductory paragraph that responds to pretty much any problem. Right?
One.
And I'm also working on synthesis, you know, is something else that you can maybe incorporate in. And then your argumentation using the documents as well. All right. Right. Does anybody have any questions about this? Okay, good. Thank you for your attention. We'll be back a week from today, Tuesday, refreshed from our time off and anxious to get back to reviewing. Till 6:30?
On the break.
Yeah, sleeping in till 6:30 would be good.
No way.
You're saying later?
Yeah.
Oh,
9 o'clock.
Oh. I can't accept that. You know, Mr. Rocco won't be able to sleep in the past. Randy, so you have a 6 p.m. practice. I heard that announcement.